genuine forgiveness. And when God accepts us, he forgives and he forgets. He buries the hatchet and doesn't leave the handle above the ground.
Stay tuned now for the Hour of Power with Robert Schuller and his dynamic message, Life's Greatest Possibilities, and his lovely guest, Jayne Meadows.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
In preparation for the morning message, hear these words from the Gospel according to St. Luke. And it happened as Jesus was alone praying that his disciples joined him, and he asked them, saying, "Who do the crowds say that I am?" So they answered and said, "John the Baptist." And others say, "Elijah." And others say that one of the old prophets has risen again. And Jesus said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Then Jesus said to them all, "If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what advantage is it if you gain the whole world and are yourselves destroyed or lost? For the Son of Man did not come to destroy, but to save." And now let us prepare our hearts for prayer. Almighty God, we thank you for Jesus Christ comes to be the international, eternal human standard, our Savior and our Lord. Come, Jesus Christ, into our lives. May we tune our lives by your melody. May we discover your salvation from guilt. May we discover the kind of faith to take chances and make decisions, that we may become real possibility thinkers. And then may our lives prosper until we're able to really have good news to share. Dear God, help us to discover the source of joy, which is Christ, our Savior and our Lord. We want to succeed in living as persons, We want to be whole individuals. We want to be healthy human beings. We want to be honest and open individuals. We want to be free persons, free from guilt, free from our sins, free from habits that tear us down or destroy us, free from negative thoughts that only create problems. We want to be saved, saved from our doubt, saved from our cynicism, saved to have joy, not because we're selfish, but because we want to be happy people for the benefit of those who have to live with us and work with us. And so, Jesus Christ, come into our lives, come into our hearts, come into our minds through your Holy Spirit. Fill us with your presence, with your power, and your peace. In your name we pray. Amen.
She'd hold me tight, and when the fever would come, she'd cool my brow. I remember it now, Mama's eyes, Jesus' eyes, gazing deeper still to the place only He could fill. Needs only
A message of hope for America. 250 million Americans of all races, of all backgrounds, the rich, the poor, in homes, in hospitals, in colleges, in prisons, in our government, the old and the young, and our U.S. ships at sea. Americans everywhere need, reach for, and hope for the Hour of Power each Sunday. In 1982, the Hour of Power became the number one rated television ministry in America, and here's why.
My wife, Connie, she said, "Why don't we watch this guy? He's really neat." And I thought, sure, another evangelist. And I'm a Christian today because of Dr. Schuller, and I really would hate to see the Hour of Power go off the air.
Tough times never last, but tough people do. And that's what this is all about right now. I'm being as tough as ever I could be. So to me, turning scars into stars, I interpret that very literally, because my scars do become stars.
I've been watching Dr. Schuller and his Hour of Power ministries for about 10 years now. There came a time in my life when the tough times hit, and you become despondent. I was without a job and I was on unemployment. But it was very good that the doctor was there to help you, to let you know that God is with you.
Hi, my name is Lou Simon, and I'm a disc jockey. I've been watching Dr. Schuller since I was a teenager, and he's inspired me through his possibility thinking to believe in myself, to have faith in myself, and through that, having faith in God.
Hi, my name is Todd Meldy, and as you can see, I work in an ice cream parlor. And I would just like to thank Dr. Schuller for everything he's done in my life. And he's helped me out with my problems as a teenager, and I think he could help a lot of other people out with their problems that are my age.
As we've seen here, the Hour of Power is reaching a broad base of persons throughout the land. No other ministry, today or ever before in history, has had the overall appeal to all walks of life and age groups as does this program. Where does our financial support come from? And what does it cost? It is costing us $33 million to air 52 Sunday programs at the Hour of Power over 170 television stations. Now, where does the support come from? 25% of our income will come from Eagles Club members. Those are persons who make a pledge or gift to this ministry of $500 or more. 38% of our support for the Hour of Power comes from friends in the response to letters I send to them each month. 27% will come from persons who respond with a gift after watching an Hour of Power television program. Now, this leaves a 10% gap in income for this ministry. This gap represents $3.3 million. By the end of our fiscal year, I must close this gap. The gap between the gifts we are receiving and the support we must have to complete this fiscal year with the Hour of Power on the air in your city and every city. Across America, don't let the light of hope that the Hour of Power brings go out. I'm asking you, all of my friends, to help me close the gap. I am believing that you will do your part. I will need to receive from all of my friends and from people whom I've never heard from before gifts to keep this program in your home every Sunday. Is it possible for you to give a tithe of 10% of your June income to this ministry? Send what you can, but do respond today. Please, don't let me stop helping you and your friends, neighbors, and loved ones in your city or town who each week draw so much hope and inspiration from this program. Now, let's you and I form a creative partnership. Let's help each other. You do that when you help me keep the Hour of Power on the air in your city. Will you write to me today? Send that letter to Robert Schuller, Garden Grove, California. Really, you and I can make a difference in your town and in our country. Remember, I must hear from you. That's only 1 week away. This Hour of Power means too much to you and to so many others to let it die now. It's a beacon of hope. Keep it burning brightly, won't you? Thank you.
have I got exciting news. You know, we like to excel. I say nothing great ever happens on the mediocre level. So anytime we do something, we want to do it the best possible, whether it's the building of a cathedral or the performance of a program. And one of my children, Jayne Schuller Dunn, had a dream, and that was the dream that our ministry could have a magazine which could take the positive hope-building faith and put it in print and pass it around this country. And I owe it all to her and the team that she pulled together. And so was born a year and a half ago the magazine Possibilities, the magazine of hope. And this past week, the Evangelical Press Association meeting in Washington, D.C., looked at the hundreds of magazines, and this magazine, Possibilities, received the highest award of excellence, and in their national magazine appears in print. I'm holding a copy here of the one of our friend Mary Martin on the cover. That happens to be our December issue. But if you're watching on television, I want you to know this is a fantastic magazine. The peers and the critics, in only a year and a half of publication, have given it their highest award. Thank you. So, if you're watching on television, would like to receive a subscription to Possibilities the first year, be my guest. Simply write to me, Robert Schuller, Garden Grove, California. It's a magazine unlike any other magazine you'll ever find anywhere in the world, because every issue will give you hope. Now, I'm so excited about our guest this morning. She has made me laugh so often. And anybody who makes you laugh becomes a minister of God's healing love. Jayne Meadows, God loves you, and so do I.
You know, you are even handsomer off television. I see him on television. You all see him in the church. We see you, and it is such an exciting thing for me to be that I have to pinch myself to think that I am in this glorious cathedral with all of you today, and I'm going to tell you why. I'm going to keep talking, and you interrupt when you feel like it. Okay?
I'll get my shot later
because,
on.
Because, okay. Yes, and you, as we say in show business, you've been on for about 15 minutes. Now I'll talk for a few. Is that okay? I want to tell all you happy people, because you've been smiling up here at me, and this is a happy church with standing room only. Think, in this day and age, over 3,000 people at this service, and I know why. My best friend in the whole world, who left us just a couple of years ago, was my mother. Dear little, beautiful little lady who was born with ballrooms in the house and servants. And as a little girl, she read a book about China. And she decided, like your Uncle Henry, that she wanted to go to China to be a missionary. And she fell in love with my father, who was from a poor family. And she said to him, I want to go to China. Now, he didn't want to go to China, but he went to the ends of the earth just to win her. And they were missionaries for 14 years in China. And in Connecticut, before she moved out here and before she left us, she said to me, Jayne, do you ever hear a program, The Hour of Power? When she retired and moved out here, for 2 years, she said, I want to go to the Crystal Cathedral. And every Sunday, I thought, next week I'll take her. Next week. And she never got here. But she's here today with my father, with Uncle Henry. And if I cry a little bit, it's okay, because I've heard you on television get emotional when you spoke about Uncle Henry. But my mother was the closest thing to a saint. No, Daddy was the saint. Mother was a real Christian, but she was the kind of Christian who told you what she thought you should know. You know the kind? And she would come up to you and give you a piece of advice, whether you wanted to hear it or not, but she was a Christian woman. And he was the saint who would just say everything was all right. He thought everything was fine with everybody. Well, Mother never got here, but today I am here with my husband, my son, my daughter-in-law. Can they stand up?
Your husband, Steve Allen. And
Bill Allen and Marie Allen.
Thank you. Thank you.
And we have so much to be thankful for because Steve has four sons. I have three stepsons and this genius, who is the youngest executive at CBS in comedy development. And that beautiful girl is the daughter I never had, my daughter-in-law that I love so much. But I must tell you that when we came down here today, this being in this church with my family is, I think, the closest thing to heaven. This beauty of this church is, you know, the little church that we had in China was patented after Chinese architecture. It was a replica of the Forbidden City. And it was almost as famous in China because it's the only Christian church in China patented after Chinese architecture, and almost as famous as this church is in America. But now I would like to tell you a little something about my father, can
yes,
I?
Please.
Because you said, you know why? I've talked so much about my mother, but I want to tell you that my father, you would have loved them both. My father believed we should have humor in the church. And he had the greatest sense of humor, like you and like Steve. And very many funny things happened. And while I was sitting here, I thought, I'm going to write a book.
Great.
Why not? And I'm going to tell some of the funny things that happened to me as a little girl in the church and that happened to my father. And I thought of one today. You know, when a clergyman performs a wedding ceremony, it's sort of a nice thing to do if you give a little gratuity that goes to the church. And years ago, during the Depression, Dad performed a ceremony, and the young man came up to him and he said, Dr. Carter, I thank you so much. Unfortunately, we're a little strapped and we're just starting out life. But he said, I work for the electric light company, and if you'll show me your meter, I'll fix it so you don't have to pay anything for 6 months. And I think I'm going to get a collection of these true stories that happened in the church. Would you all buy my book? Thank you. And I will donate the money to the spread of Christianity in China today. In memory of my parents.
Great, great.
I think so.
The church, is it still standing?
Oh, the church is not only still standing, but Steve and Bill have been back and visited the church. And the Chinese, it's a school today because it's their architecture. Many of the churches in China were just used to store grain, but not ours. And they brought Steve and Bill in and were lovely to you, weren't they, dear? Yes, they welcomed them in the church. And, I'm so proud of my family. I thank God every day of my life. Aren't I blessed?
Most richly blessed. Now, I want to ask a question.
Yes.
At home, alone, in the family,
yes,
who dominates the conversation, Steve or you?
Oh! Well, you can see who does. But you see, still waters run deep. Mm-hmm. And I'm the bird brain. But I'm gregarious, and I love to talk.
I would never have guessed.
Oh, Dr. Schuller! But Steve is always composing or thinking, writing, thinking of jokes and things, and I'm a walking straight line. And everything I say, he makes a joke on. That's why I'm so glad he's not up here today, or nobody would be listening to me. But I do want to boast one more thing about Steve, because as many of you know, he's written over 5,000 songs. One of them, which was recorded by Nat King Cole and Margaret Whiting and many other people, is called Let's Go to Church Next Sunday Morning. And I want him to record it again and let me sing it.
Here,
and
he, here.
Oh, here. My dear. Well, he'll sing it here.
Okay.
I wouldn't do that to your congregation, hearing me sing it.
Okay.
But he also has written the most magnificent suite. It's a symphonic called Emmanuel that he wrote, and he does it with symphony orchestras all over the United States. Now, that would be lovely to do here.
That would be great. Shouldn't we have it?
Yes.
That's it's the
beautiful.
Invitation.
Beautiful. Beautiful. Oh, I'm so glad to be here with you. I watch you.
Thank you.
And my mother is watching you now.
Thank you.
She loved you very, very much.
You have given the world so much, and I want to give you a special little blessing. May God give you an unexpected surprise of joy and a hearty laugh before every sunset of your life.
Oh.
God loves you, and so do I. Thank you, Jayne Meadows. Thank you. Thank you. I am very happy now to introduce the next anthem that's about to be sung. It is written by Dr. Marjorie Elliott, who has composed over 1,000 pieces of music in her lifetime. 400 are published. She is internationally recognized in the musical circles as one of the great professionals of our time. She will be accompanying the anthem at the piano. She is today 92 years of age. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Elliott. Keep well, come back soon. We'll be listening to you on the keyboard on your 100th birthday. God loves you, so do I. Thank you very much. I think the most interesting people in the world are taxi drivers. Mrs. Schuller and I got into a taxi the other day in a town, and he was a remarkable character. 68 years of age, and he claims he's on the second grade level. He was kicked out of his family when he was a teenager, born into the pocket of poverty in this country, and on a reservation, actually. And he said, but I'm learning. I hope to hit the third grade level next year. But he's still unable to read and write. Interesting character. Then he talked all the way from the airport to our hotel about all kinds of things, one subject to another. I said, do you ever watch television? Never. I don't learn anything from it. I felt safe. Too safe, as it turned out, because the next subject he brought up was preachers. If he had just hung in with preachers, I could handle it. But then he got into television evangelists. I'll bet you can guess what he said. I said, well, do you believe in the church or Christianity? Well, I don't know. He said, I've never married, 68 years of age. All the hookers are friends of mine. And everybody's jealous of me because I get everything I want and I don't have any responsibility with kids. Kind of shocking. I said, well, do you believe in God? He said, oh, yes. And he said, I would like to someday meet God and ask him one question. I said, what's that? He said, I'd like to ask him, why in the world he put human beings on planet Earth? Oh, I said, he's answered that question. He said, he has? I said, yes, in the Bible. Oh, he said, I can't read. What does the Bible say? I said, well, the Bible says that God put human beings on planet Earth because God wanted to be in every little nook and cranny and corner on planet Earth. And he thought, I'll design myself a creature that can be something like me, thinking thoughts, talking, helping, lifting, smiling, encouraging people, showing love. Oh, he said, that makes sense. And I said, yes, you see, but what keeps us from really being good members of that family of God is that we have our own sins. And we don't smile enough probably, or we don't offer a helping hand quick enough, or we turn the other way when we hear a cry in the night and it disturbs our sleep and our rest. So we all need forgiveness, you know. But I said, exciting thing is, God has drawn to himself to make certain that love will never be totally extinguished, and to be confident that the divine light will never be permanently put out, God has chosen to himself his special family. And that's what the Old Testament is about. The Jews, they were God's chosen people to make sure that the world would know that there is a God and that he's ethical and moral and upright and cares. And then finally, God was very good. He came into this world in Jesus Christ, and he said, I've decided to enlarge my family to include not just Jews, but to also welcome anybody of any race or color or national origin. And hence was born the Christian church, or the kingdom of God, or I like to call it God's enlarged family worldwide. I like to think of it this way. In the family of God, God is the heavenly Father. The church is the mother. And Jesus Christ is everybody's older brother. And you know, there's nothing like the older brother, because you always feel free to talk to the older brother, even if you don't dare to talk to mother and father, right?
The older brother is the one person you can always feel safe in sharing your secrets with. And then maybe he'll say, "That's okay. I think we ought to talk to Dad and Mom about it." Christ is our elder brother. The family of God. Fantastic. And you know, the exciting thing about the family of God is the benefits we have. The first is acceptance. I mean, genuine acceptance. You know, Robert Frost said it, a family is a place where when you go there, they cannot put you out. The family, it was the original small therapeutic group. Someone asked me once a few years ago, "Dr. Schuller, you should belong to one of these small groups, therapeutic groups." I said, "I do." They said, "Which one?" I said, "My family." Because the dynamics of therapy in small group therapy is that everybody has to be honest with each other, but it has to be a tough love, which means brutally honest, but at the same time reinforcing and reaffirming. That's what a family is. That means the family is the place where they love me after they have seen me at my worst. The family, that's the one place where even though we may be disagreeing and having strong separations of opinion, when tragedy strikes or the enemy attacks, the family comes to the rescue. Why? When I was in Korea, Carol had her accident. It took me many hours to get from Korea to the Sioux City, Iowa hospital. By the time I got there, my one daughter had already flown from Chicago to be at her bedside. My son had flown from London, England, where he was leading a tour, to get to her bedside. My daughter, Sheila, had flown from California to Sioux City, Iowa, to be at her bedside. The family comes running to the rescue. Ah, non-judgmental love, genuine acceptance, without being phony. That's what a family is. And belonging to the family of God means this, that God accepts you, doesn't expect you to be perfect, doesn't. Christians aren't perfect, we just happen to know where to go to get pardon and forgiveness. We go to Jesus. Genuine forgiveness. And when God accepts us, he forgives and he forgets. He buries the hatchet and doesn't leave the handle above the ground. Love a story that I heard a while back of a little girl in the Philippines who claimed to see the Virgin Mary. And then she said, it's supposed to be a true story. Then she claimed that Jesus appeared to her. Well, you know, the news spread and she became sort of a celebrity. Finally, it reached her priest and her priest checked it out and thought maybe there's something to this. Maybe she does see the Virgin. Maybe, in fact, she does see Jesus. Finally, she drew such crowds that it reached the archbishop, and the archbishop called the girl in, and he said, "You see the Virgin Mary?" She said, "Yes." "And you see Jesus?" "Yes." And she said, "He talks to me." "Oh, does he? What does he say?" "Oh, many things." The archbishop paused and he said, "Little lady, do you think he'll come back and see you again and talk with you again?" She said, "Oh, sure." "When?" "I don't know." "Well, next time he comes to you, will you ask him a question for me?" She said, "Certainly, sir." The archbishop said, "The next time you see Jesus, ask him, what was the last sin that the archbishop confessed?" The little lady said, "I will, Your Excellency." Some months later, he got a call. It was the girl. "I've seen him." "Oh," he said, "please come in." She sat down. "Did you talk?" "Yes." "Did you ask him the question?" She said, "Yes." "I want to make sure you understood the question. What did you ask him?" "I said to him, Jesus, I talked to the archbishop and he asked me to ask you, what was the last sin that he confessed? And the archbishop said, oh, and what did he say? She said, he looked at me, put his hand to his head, looked up and said, I can't remember. The scriptures say that he forgives our sins and remembers them no more. You want emotional, spiritual health and get your act together internally, psychologically? Wow. Have an experience of being accepted by the holiest, who knows what you've been at your worst. That's a process of, some call it getting saved, some call it getting born again, depends upon traditions. Some call it becoming a member of the family of God. Some call it simply becoming a Christian. Some call it finding faith. Whatever you call it, it's for real. It really is. Family of God. God is the Father. The Church is the Mother. Christ is my elder brother. And all of us are trying to help each other and encourage each other. That's wonderful. We find our greatest joy in that, you know. I remember Dr. Louis Evans, who is a dear friend of mine. I'm talking about Louis Evans Sr. Louis Evans Jr. is also a dear friend, and he's in Presbyterian Church in Washington. But Dr. Evans went to visit a Korean missionary in Korea years ago. A doctor, incidentally, who had an opportunity to have a very lucrative practice in America, but rather chose to accept his divine calling and go to the Korean people. And Louis went with him on one of his road trips down those winding, bumpy roads, and they can be impossible. But they found that they came to a little tent, and there the doctor set up his little temporary surgical unit, and they brought in this Korean woman, and there in the heat, he performed surgery that lasted 6 hours. And when it was all finished, and he was scrubbing up, he said to Louis, well, I think we've got that one fixed up. And Louis said to him, I'm curious, doctor. In Korea here, what do you get for an operation like this? Oh, he said, interesting you should ask. And he reached in his pocket and he got out a dented copper coin. He said, to begin with, I got this. She came to me and said, doctor, can you help me? This is what I can pay you. And I looked at it and I said, well, isn't that interesting? That's exactly what I charge for this particular surgery. So he said, to begin with, I got that. But he said, with tears now welling in his eyes, what I got beyond that, and he held out his scrubbed hands, he said, for 6 hours, I had the wonderful feeling that these were 10 fingers for God. I felt for 6 hours, these were the hands of Jesus healing the sick. You want self-esteem, self-worth? There's a beautiful Bible verse, Christ in you, your hope of glory. Well, you can't all be doctors, I can't, but all of you can offer a helping hand, a smile, and a touch, and a listening ear, and that's about all some people need, and they will meet the Lord. God is waiting to adopt you into his family if you don't feel you're a part of it. Do you feel in or out? Glory of Easter was held here. Over 100,000 people saw reenacted in dramatic terms without parallel on the stage of the world the last days, the suffering, and the crucifixion, and the resurrection of Jesus. And the members of the cast, 400 volunteers, would go to the doors and greet people as they left. And one of our members said to me, she said, this young man came out. He was probably 22 years of age. And his garb, his dress, bespoke a lifestyle that probably meant he never went to church. And he came out and I shook hands with him and he had tears in his eyes. And I welcomed him and I said, I have a member here. Do you go to church? And then she said, suddenly, he started crying, and he said,
I found him tonight. And he began to sob. She hugged him. And he repeated it, I found him here tonight. And then he put his head back and said, or maybe he found me. The hound of heaven, the footsteps of Jesus. Can't you feel them? Can't you hear them behind you? Have you ever been in a room and you sensed that someone was staring at the back of your head and you turned and sure enough, your eyes met theirs? And don't you once in a while feel that there's someone looking at you from the back or the side or above you? And you resist meeting their gaze because it might be something that gets you involved and you're not ready for that. You have other things in front of you. Malcolm Muggeridge, whom I hope to see next week in London, sent some lines that touched me. They're in his latest book, actually. Oh, I wish I had them here because I can't do justice. But essentially he says this. I walk down the street and occasionally a head turns recognizing my face. That's fame. At this point in my life, I find it easy to earn enough to put me in the highest category for the Internal Revenue Service. That is success. From time to time, I hear a word or two from one of my writings quoted, referred to, enough so that I can encourage myself to believe that I made something of an impact on society in my life. That is fulfillment. And if you are fortunate as I am to become an old man, not wanting of money, recognition, or fame, you will be able to afford a variety of divergent enjoyments. That's pleasure. Yet, I tell you, I beg you to believe me. I plead and pray that you will take my sentence seriously. All of these, collectively, are nothing compared to one drink of that water that never runs dry. The love that I have for Christ and that He has for me. You get the feeling somebody's looking at you, behind you, and you've avoided the gaze. Turn around, and you can say, I found him, or did he find me? Either way, you'll become a part of a great family of God. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, that you have not left the world spinning without a divine direction. And Father, help us to see the possibilities of recovering our pride as human beings again. And then may we have the faith that we can cope with what now appear to be horrific and unsolvable potential problems that face our planet. For with God, all things are possible. I pray now for a person in this congregation, a second, a third, a fourth, yes, even more, that came here, never once having turned their face to dare to meet the stare of the loving, silent one, Christ Jesus, who lives. Thank you, Jesus. We accept you now as our Savior and Lord, and we put our feet to a path and can expect for sure that it shall run into the sunshine that never sets. Amen.
In the church, my
the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may God give you his peace in your going out and in your coming in your lying down and in your rising up, in your labor and in your leisure, in your laughter and in your tears, until you come to stand before Jesus in that day in which there is no sunset and no dawning. Amen.
Earlier this morning, we saw how the Hour of Power is bringing hope and enthusiasm each week to the lives of persons in homes, in hospitals, in colleges, and in prisons, to the rich and to the poor. You and I, through the Hour of Power, are changing lives. How can we continue this good work? You know, we pay for every minute of airtime to come into your town, into your home. Where will the support come from? Obviously, from people who want this ministry to keep on keeping on. All gifts, of course, are tax deductible. It is costing us $33 million to air 52 Sunday programs at the Hour of Power over 170 television stations. Now, where does the support come from? 25% of our income will come from Eagles Club members. Those are persons who make a pledge or gift to this ministry of $500 or more. 38% of our support for the Hour of Power comes from friends in their response to letters I send to them each month. 27% will come from persons who respond with a gift after watching an Hour of Power television program. Now, this leaves a 10% gap in income for this ministry. This gap represents $3.3 million. By the end of our fiscal year, I must close this gap. The gap between the gifts we are receiving and the support we must have to complete this fiscal year with the Hour of Power on the air in your city and every city across America. Don't let the light of hope that the Hour of Power brings go out. I'm asking you, all of my friends, to help me close the gap. I am believing that you will do your part. I will need to receive from all of my friends and from people whom I've never heard from before gifts to keep this program in your home every Sunday. Is it possible for you to give a tithe of 10% of your June income to this ministry? Send what you can, but do respond today. Please, don't let me stop helping you and your friends, neighbors, and loved ones in your city or town who each week draw so much hope and inspiration from this program. Now, let's you and I form a creative partnership. Let's help each other. You do that when you help me keep the Hour of Power on the air in your city. Will you write to me today? Send that letter to Robert Schuller, Garden Grove, California. Really, you and I can make a difference in your town and in our country. Remember, I must hear from you. That's only 1 week away. This Hour of Power means too much to you and to so many others to let it die now. It's a beacon of hope. Keep it burning brightly, won't you? Thank you.